Good afternoon. I am really excited to be talking today, even though this is just 10 minutes. I have the luxury of talking about incident management in that time frame because there's so much amazing context and content that's being provided through the rest of the talks. So we just heard about trust and building trust, and everything that I talk about in the next 10 minutes presupposes a healthy engineering culture, specifically around incidents, what Sydney Decker calls a just culture that's built on trust, learning, and accountability. Now, I don't have time to dive into that, but everything I talk about assumes that that's already in place. So what am I going to talk about today? Well, I'm going to focus our lens in on incident management, and in particular, the incident commander role. So what can we do today in 10 minutes to talk about incident response? Well, we can define what incident management and incident commander is. We can talk about, and sorry, I'm going to see if I can get the slides to advance, perhaps. Oh, there we go. Great, thank you. We can talk about what an incident commander is, what an incident commander knows, what they bring to the table to make an incident go well, and what an incident commander does to improve outcomes, not just speeding up resolution time, but also increasing the learning that happens during incidents. So let's start by talking about what an incident commander actually is. For that matter, what is an incident? So Liz Fong-Jones talked earlier a little bit about incident response, what happens when an emergency arises. Your definition of an incident is going to hinge on your customers, your industry, your approach to reliability, what your SLOs are. That's all very personal. But incidents are always some kind of disruption to the business's ability to fulfill its basic function. And for us, we're looking at that through the lens of engineering. Production systems are down, customers aren't able to do what they need to do, and you need to respond very quickly. So what I'm going to focus on are some of the aspects of incident response that shape the incident commander role. So incident response is characterized by high stakes, business critical systems, what is happening really matters to the business. They're characterized as well by high cadence. Now, there's always time pressure in engineering, but we're talking about a different level of urgency here. We're going to be making different decisions and going through a different process, even than an urgent project deadline. Very high cadence activities. And I'm going to be looking at incidents as a form of group activity. Now, sometimes you have one engineer solving a problem, but those aren't the kinds of incidents that I'm going to be focusing on. I'm looking at group activity where even if you have one engineer and, say, customer support looking for regular updates, a situation where you need someone to coordinate that response. That person is the incident commander. So the incident commander is an individual, one person, not a committee, who coordinates incident response. And it's critical here to understand that the incident commander is not in charge of solving the technical problem. They are in charge of solving the human systems problem. So when you have an incident, you need someone who can act as a therapist, as a translator, and as a coach. That person is the incident commander, or IC. So what does an incident commander need to know when they step on the scene to facilitate this process? Well, first of all, they need to understand the incident response process itself. This assumes that there is an explicit incident response process. Now, a lot of organizations have very ad hoc incident response processes. The processes exist, but they may be implicit. It's very important that these processes and tools be made explicit, even if you have a very light touch. We're going to have a talk a little bit later about how to set up good process for your organization. So making sure that incident response process is clear, well documented, and agreed upon throughout the organization is critical. The incident commander should have a good grasp of what's the incident lifecycle, what are your severity definitions, what differentiates between a one alarm and a five alarm fire, what the communication medium is going to be, where are you communicating about what's happening, and tracking your activities. The incident commander should know all of that walking in so that they can guide that process effectively. And they also need to have a good high-level grasp of the systems at play. This includes the technical systems. And again, they don't necessarily need to be an expert engineer because they're not solving the technical problem. But they do need to be able to have productive conversations with the people who are troubleshooting. They need to understand the human systems at play, the nature of the organization, who's likely to participate in an incident, what do they care about. And they need to understand the priorities in resolving an incident. At New Relic, for example, we care a lot more about data ingest and retention. We will actually sacrifice the UI experience if it means that we're going to save data. Your priorities might be flipped. You're going to be making trade-offs under high pressure, so you need to know up front what can you sacrifice and what do you need to fight for. So an incident commander steps on the scene, takes over managing the incident response. What does that actually look like? What are they doing that improves outcomes? What the incident commander needs to do is regulate the flow of the incident itself. And there are three flows that I'm going to talk about: emotion, information, and analysis. So the first flow to regulate is emotion. We've been hearing about this today, right? The amygdala, the reptile brain. We've got high stakes, high cadence group activities. Emotions are going to be running high. So we're all familiar with the three classic responses to danger: fight, flight, or freeze. Ironically, when you most need your prefrontal cortex engaged in running the show, it gets flooded with stress hormones, and you either freak out or curl up into the fetal position in the corner, right? Being aware of those responses and being able to guide people out of them is priority number one in an emergency situation. So, fight. If people get combative, cool things down. Flight. If people start panicking, running around with their hands in the air, you need to slow them down and get them to think in a more measured way. And freeze. Some people are going to get stuck. You're going to freeze up and spin their wheels. You need to get them moving, get them thinking in more productive and active ways. So pay attention to the emotions in the room. Be aware of these responses. And if you can help people get into a calm, focused state of mind, you're going to drastically speed up the time that it takes to resolve a problem. The next flow to regulate is the flow of information. And this is largely about understanding who's in the room. Who's there? What do they already know? What do they need to know that they care about? So your engineers know their systems. They care about the details of the problem so that they can pitch in to resolving the problem. Customer support does not care about the details of the problem. They want to know, what is the current and potential customer impact? How can they communicate effectively? Executives, legal, security, everybody needs a translator in the room who speaks their particular language. So doing this effectively involves listening to everything that's happening, filtering it, and surfacing what is actually meaningful to the right people. Do you need to pull more people into the room? Do you need to kick some people out of the room? Do you need to bring in additional resources, even if it's just lunch because people are hungry? Acting as that conduit to get the right information to the right people is one way that an incident commander can reduce friction and speed up time to resolution. And the final flow to regulate is that of analysis. Now, once in a while, you get an obvious incident where you know what's wrong, you know exactly what to do to fix it, and it's just implementing the repair. That's lovely. But as Maggie Zhou was talking about earlier, often we have these hidden system complexities that get surfaced, right? We have the unknown unknowns. These incidents are scary, but they're also really useful because they show us where our mental models of the system don't align with reality, as well as where our mental models of the system don't align with that of the person sitting next to us. So they're really valuable events, even though they're really stressful. So in these situations, an incident commander can regulate the flow of the incident, not by knowing the right answers, but by asking the right questions. challenging assumptions, asking for proof, asking people, how do you know that's true? Even if you don't understand the answer to their question, getting them to articulate the process in real time for themselves and the people around them is going to surface a lot of important information and assumptions, and again, help to speed up the entire process. The other thing that you can do is amplify voices. Since you're not actually solving the technical problem, you have more bandwidth. You can keep your ear out for those oddball theories, and you're going to have to filter out the bogus ones, but you're going to be able to pop those up and ask people, what about this? We assumed this wasn't the case. What if it is? So incidents themselves are high stakes, high cadence group activities. They need someone to manage the flow so that they will go better. That person needs to understand the incident command process in the first place. They need to understand both the human and technical systems that are at play, and they need to understand the priorities of the business in resolving those incidents. They can do that by regulating the flow of emotion, regulating the flow of information, and helping people with the process of analysis during an incident. For all of their stress, incidents are incredibly rich sources of information about the hidden properties of our systems, and we would do well to benefit more from them. So I would love to continue this conversation, hear your best of incidents, have you challenge my assumptions about the process, and in general geek out about things going badly. Thank you.